So thank you for joining. And what I'll propose to do is just go through the topic, which is an introduction to project planning procedures. And in terms of a little introduction, flip this slide. Go. Yeah, so my name is Tom Francis. I'm director of a business called Decipher. We operate across the UK and internationally. And our core area of work is time and money on projects. So we look at quantity surveying and project planning across the whole project lifecycle. My area of interest and where I've worked for pretty much all my career is in the time side of things, so project planning, hence the topic of today's talk. I've been actively involved with the CIOB for a number of years, and I'm actually currently the Managed to Hub Chair. And I'll touch on at the end of this talk what we do at the CIOB, and hopefully for any students, put your interest in perhaps attending some of our events. We're more than welcome you along to any of those, whether they be online or in person over the course of 2022. As I said, I've spent pretty much all my career in construction management. That was where I started my degree over 20 years ago. And since then, it's been pretty much focused on this area of project planning. And more recently, a facet of project planning known as delay analysis. And I'll touch on that as we go through the slide. So hopefully, for anyone listening in, I can hopefully distill a little bit of knowledge on project planning to you in terms of what it is, how we go about planning works on construction projects, and then touch on some of the career aspects of a role in project planning, which I'm really keen to advocate. I think it's a good part of the industry to be involved in. So that's a little bit about me. In terms of the presentation, probably be about 30 minutes, 40 minutes or so. And then we've got a bit of time at the end for any questions or discussion. I'm keen to hear perhaps views of students or course leaders who perhaps are listening in as to your views on project planning in general. And that's at the end. And obviously the contents are as follows. So I'll just set the scene of what project planning is and how I see it fitting into any construction project. And how we, well, the importance of planning in general to any business. I'll then just touch on how we as project planners go about creating the plan and how that evolves as an element of good project management. I'll then touch on some of the different programming techniques that we use and are available to convey that plan to a wider audience of stakeholders on any project. I'll then just touch on briefly how you update a programme as a project progresses and the importance of that. And then I'll touch on at the end, hopefully the most important bit is planning as a career, which I've really enjoyed, and hopefully can explain that in a little bit more detail to anyone who perhaps has an interest in it further. So that's the contents. And in terms of starting then at the start, what is project planning? I guess in my eyes, project planning is key function of successful project delivery. It's that time element of the project. And I'm sure many of you listening will be familiar with the project triangle of key deliverables for any successful project, whether that be cost, quality, and time. Of course, they're all competing in some respects in terms of the importance of one another to any project. But clearly, you know, delivering on time is a key requirement for many different developments. Obviously within that cost quality triangle is the more important thing of health, safety, environment, which I think sits at the core and is the one thing that isn't compromised. But then amongst the other three, then clearly there is that competing requirements of each. In terms of the project planning, that all really is to do with the time element of any successful project. And that's where the role of the planner really fits within any project delivery team. So clearly cost is, you know, the domain of the perhaps the quantity surveyors, quality, health and safety, perhaps the role of the project managers and site management team mainly, and then time, obviously the role of the planner. And that's the area I've really focused on throughout my career. In terms of planning in at a higher level in general terms, I think, you know, we just need to remind ourselves of the importance of planning within any business environment or any organization. And as I see it, perhaps that's distilled into three main strands. So at the upper level, we have obviously the strategic decision making and planning that goes on at board level, which is long term in nature, is really to set the direction of the business in terms of its business plan, its mission, its vision, what it's looking to achieve over the full life of that business for many, many years. Obviously, below that, then that long-term strategy needs to be distilled into specific business units over the shorter term, where you have what's perhaps termed more technical plans over a shorter duration. And then below that, we have the operational planning within that organization, which is there to support the tactical plans and achievement of those overriding operational goals. In terms of project planning, I really see that sitting within operations. So that is, you know, delivery of individual projects successfully on time. Maybe there's a number of projects within the organization, which really feeds into achieving those overall aims of the business as a whole. So it's really, it's the operational element I'll concentrate on in a little bit more detail as I go through these slides that follow. And that's the area I focused on in terms of sort of live project delivery of live projects. So with that in mind, in terms of the general nature of planning in any organization, if we touch on then planning within construction projects, as I see it, you know, the planning of a unique project starts at the outset, and that planning function doesn't stop there. It really goes through the whole of the life cycle of the project. So typically, as a project planner, you will be involved in developing a tender plan. So this is a program that reflects how long that that project that you're tendering is likely to take. And that really is a key function of the tender process, because it really does inform the estimating department and the delivery team of how long it's likely to take. And that has a huge impact on the cost side of things in terms of prelim costs and the like and such like. So, you know, it's a real key function of the tender is to establish a proper tender program. So really, as I say, planning starts right at the outset of any project. If you're successful in terms of contract award post-tender, then typically that tender program will be developed into a contract program. So a program that is reflective of the contract requirements, so the starting date, completion date, any key dates in between, reflective of the scope that you're expected to deliver against. So it's certainly coming more to the fore over recent years, the role of the program at the outset. And you see that when you look at certain contracts. If you take, for example, the NEC suite of contracts, the program is really at the heart of that under core clause 3. You know, you can really see the role of the program in terms of the management of the project and management of the contract itself is becoming quite important. Once that contract program is set up, we have what I call term live planning. So that program will be monitored on usually a monthly basis, sometimes on a more shorter periods, perhaps weekly, to really see whether that original plan is proceeding as intended, whether there's any changes to the rate of progress, which has an implication on the forward-looking element of the program that remains, whether the critical path alters and such like. So planning is really a key function of the project, even once it's commenced. And I'll touch on in the slides that follow how you update a program once you've created it and some of the key elements to consider as the project is progressing. You then perhaps get to project completion, project closeout, and in some occasions, if there's, you know, a situation where there's perhaps a dispute, the role of that program is then utilized to consider what was intended by the parties to that contract and how that might have differed against reality and who is potentially liable under the terms of that contract, those issues that have arisen. So you can see here that, you know, planning is, so the message I'm trying to get over is that planning is something that starts at the outset of a project and covers a whole life cycle right through to completion and successful delivery of those works. So that's the broad aspects of planning across construction. If we start then with just considering the plan itself, and I'll touch on the difference in these slides between, as I see it, the plan and the programme. And I think the starting point is always to think of the plan first. And the plan, in my eyes, is something that's owned by the whole project team. It's something that the whole project team has an input into. And then it is for the role of the planner to produce the programme that conveys that message to the wider team members and various stakeholders to that project. So starting at the outset in terms of the plan, it's really the strategy for how you're going to deliver that scheme. So in terms of what is the scope that we're delivering, what are the contractual requirements we are to deliver against, what are the constraints of the site on our works, and then to really get into the detail of the works themselves or your scope of delivery. So looking at the tasks you're due to do, whether that be from looking perhaps at the drawings, from the bill of quantities and so forth, the specifications, to really get a feel for how you're going to break that project into an appropriate level of detail, whether that be individual activities, whether that be splitting the works into different parts of the site and such like. Thereafter, usually when we consider the plan, it's considering how long each task within that plan will take to perform. And I'll touch in a bit of detail on how we go about that. It's not simply only using your experience as a planner, but it's also doing something a little bit more quantitative in terms of looking at the work output that's required, in terms of quantities of work, standard output rates for how much the workforce can achieve and such like. So I'll touch on that in a couple of slides, how we develop the durations of activities. And then thereafter, we need to put that in some logical sequence, some order of how those tasks will be performed. Touching on the consideration of the relationship between those activities. So whether you need to finish one activity before you start the next, so that's denoted at the bottom with an FS, which is finish to start. Whether you can start one activity after the one has started, which is the start to start, finish to finish and so forth. The basis of putting that relationship into the program is essentially to create what we call a closed network. So a network of relationships between those activities. And in essence, that's known as the critical path method. And again, I'll touch on that in a little bit of detail in the slides that follow. So I think the initial observation is when you're creating the plan, the key for me is it's owned by everyone. The planner can lead on developing it, but it's really important that planner gets the buy-in from the project delivery team, the project manager, the project director, the buying team in terms of procurement and the quantity surveying team and so forth. So that, you know, right from the outset, it's not just the planner who has created a program in the software. It's actually a plan that everyone is bought into. I do find that that leads to more successful outcomes if that attitude is it set out from the outset amongst that project team. So that's the kind of the broad parameters of producing a plan. I'll touch on each in a little bit of detail in these slides that follow. So if we start, that's a little bit too far, we start here. So I think, as I said, the first task is to work out your scope of what you're to deliver under the contract. Typically, that's by looking at the contract drawings, the tender drawings, the contract itself as to any requirements you need to deliver against, the specifications and so forth. Also, it's really important at the outset, if you're tendering, to visit the site. I've always found you get a much greater feel for the site in person when you're there than any photographs or such like that you look at. And that will give you a feel for the constraints that will have an impact on your programme and how long it may take to perform those works. And as I said a moment ago, get input from all the team members because they will have a wealth of knowledge that can feed into your programme to make it the most optimal programme for delivery. On the right, I've set out some simple activities a reasonably high level to give an example of how we would build a program from first principles and from the start for a simple golf club extension. And you'll see there the list of simple activities I'm going to walk through in a bit of detail. First activity of the project start. So perhaps that's a milestone that's from the contract that says you're going to start on a particular date. You may then, having visited the site, realise that there's a site strip that's required before you can even start any excavations. Thereafter, excavation foundations, brick and block up to DPC level. You then will potentially install the ground floor slab. You then continue the brick and block to roof level. So this is a traditional type build in this example. In parallel with the brickwork, you will potentially have to install some scaffolding, after which you can put the roof works in to get the building watertight to allow any internal mechanical and electrical fit out works to progress to project completion. And again, project completion might be defined in your contract. So it's really at the outset is to get a feel for what you have to deliver from a broad spectrum of documents, as well as drawing upon visiting the site itself, to really get a feel for how you might go about developing this scheme from the outset through to completion. I think once you've established the broad sort of activities involved in any plan, the key then is to look at how long each task may take to perform. Quite often, people who do planning draw upon their own experience. They say, well, I've looked at the drawings and it's approximately 4 weeks to undertake that task. I think that element of qualitative experience is helpful, but it shouldn't detract from the basic principle of planning, in my eyes, is a sort of an estimating function. So typically, if you produce a program, the key is to consider the quantities of work, which is you usually do a takeoff of the drawings. So you'll measure the takeoff of the main elements of works. It's not every single trade, but it's usually the key trades. So typically groundworks, the number of piles you need to install, the brickwork on the project, the plastering involved and such like. And what I've got here is a simple example of, in this instance, on this scheme, let's suppose we have 1500 meter squared brickwork, which should be measured from a simple takeoff of the drawings. Let's suppose a bricklayer can, based upon the output of your business, typically do 500 bricks per day. Maybe a little optimistic that example. Each individual business will have their own output rates, typically, that they'll draw upon. But let's suppose in this instance, that's what this organization can typically achieve. That's circa 63 bricks per hour. We know that there's approximately 60 bricks in a meter squared, therefore it's 0.95 hours per meter squared. If we multiply that hourly output by the number of bricks on the scheme, we can see that we have just over 1400 hours to complete this task, typically. Again, dividing that by, let's say, a 40-hour week leads us to conclude that we need approximately 36 bricklayer weeks. And then you'll perhaps look at the drawings and work out, well, we can probably put on, say, three gangs of two bricklayers on this scheme without them being too constrained in terms of working too closely to one another. This equates to a six-week activity using three gangs that we will apply to our program. Typically, however, that is perhaps an optimum assessment, not accounting for any potential risks that may apply to that area, that element of work. So typical risks could include design change, lack of access. More recently, we've had, you know, one risk is that people have been off because of COVID, which perhaps would reduce your ability to achieve those six bricklayers on a typical day. In my experience, in terms of bricklaying, the key risk is weather. Perhaps you're going to do these works in the winter, you'd apply a weather factor, possibly over 15%, which is why I've given to it here. That equates to circa 7 week activity instead of the six. So we've built in a little bit of time risk allowance, is a better term, into that activity. And so that's the kind of a simple example of how I think you should plan works at the outset to give your program some credibility in terms of it being achievable, and you have some measure to compare that against and to explain to other stakeholders how you've got to the correct allocation of time for each activity. Once you develop those durations for the key trades, we then typically will look to apply that to the program. And the usual way of doing that is a typical planning software, as I show on the screen here. The key task then is to consider what relationship there is between each of those activities. So in this example here, we're starting this scheme on the 1st of October 2021. That might well be derived from the contract itself. The employer may well have imposed that as a start date. You then obviously have to start at the outset, which is site strip works, excavation and so forth, and they flow through to the end of the works. And what I've done in this example is I've overlapped activities which can be overlapped, and I've not overlapped ones which can't. So typically here, I've assumed that this site is quite a large site, and once you're circa two-thirds of the way through the site strip, the excavation can then commence at the other end of the site, and so forth. If I take another example, we can see activity five, the foundations. I'm saying in this example here, that needs to be complete before the brick and block to DPC level, simply because the brick and block is quite a short duration activity. You wouldn't want to overlap it too much, but you essentially as a planner need to consider the relationship between tasks and then the software. Using the software, you can link those together to form that closed network. That critical path is then derived from the software itself. It creates that critical path based upon how link your activities together, and also based upon the duration of those activities. So this golf club extension, which we set out the tasks at the outset from the drawings, from the visit in the site, from the scope of works, we then considered those durations for individual tasks. So if you look at activity eight in this example here, brick and block work to roof level is 7 weeks. I've determined that 7 weeks from that simple quantity takeoff, applying a standard output rate to that element of works to work out how many bricklayer weeks are required for that unique task. So that's essentially the process of creating the plan based upon, as I say, first principles of quantities of work and the scope of works. I touched on a moment ago the logic between the different activities. So just a simple example here is you can see activity 6 to 7, brick and block work linking to the ground floor slab, is a finish to start relationship. What I'm supposing there is that you are going to pour this slab in one pour. So you need to put all your brick and block around the whole of the perimeter before you pour the slab that sits within that, put that in place. So that is, you need to finish the brick and block work before you start the next activity. If, however, you consider activities 8 and 9, this is the brickwork from ground floor level to roof and the scaffolding, I'm showing that as a start to start relationship. Typically, you will install an element of brickwork up to perhaps head height, and then you typically need to install the first lift of scaffolding that goes alongside that. So there's a relationship between the rate of output of brickwork and scaffolding. Because of that, they are overlapping one another. And then if you look at the end, as a further type of relationship, you can see there's a finish to finish relationship between the mechanical and electrical works and the fit out. So towards the end of the project, what I'm saying here is you need to finish all of the mechanical electrical works before you can then finish the final elements of fit out. That could be joinery, it could be ceilings, it could be decoration, such like, which typically is done once all the main mechanical electrical works are installed. So it's really important, I think, when you're building a program to consider what activities can overlap, how much they can overlap by, and those which can't, based upon logical sequencing. So that's how we essentially create a simple program. Hopefully that conveys the basics of producing a plan from scratch. I think one really important point to note, once you've built your program or as you're building it, consider restrictions on that program, which we typically call constraints. So constraints to me are things which are outside of that program, which may have an impact on how long the project will take to deliver. Now, this could be things such as planning permission from a local authority, or obtaining licenses, typical licenses, oversailing licenses for cranes, which can take an inordinate amount of time, and if they're not in place, can really affect your program. Restrictions again, perhaps from the local authority, approvals and sign-off from the employer or any end users that are going to use the building typically can have an impact on your program if they're not identified in that program from the outset. In more recent years, one constraint has been social distancing in terms of we've had obviously COVID. The Construction Leadership Council imposed guidance on working close to one another and other measures to deal with the effects of COVID. That in itself has had an impact on how much work you can achieve. And you know, that's something to consider in any program in more recent years. And then things such as, you know, long lead-in periods for particular large elements of plant, or any constraints on the site itself, such as local properties or boundaries, that will affect how much work you can achieve based on those general constraints. So build your program and then think about those things which are outside of the control of you as a contractor, which will potentially impact your program if they're not considered at the outs. And again, if these are a key consideration, show them on your program, show the logic between these constraints, how they could affect your works from the outset. That's typically the plan. As I say, the plan should be owned by everyone, but led by the planner in terms of producing it. Once you produce the plan, the question then is, how do you convey that plan to others? And in essence, this in my mind is called programming. So this is the reflection of that plan in a format that's understandable by the wider members of the team. So on the top left, we have the traditional bar or Gantt chart, first developed by Henry Gantt at the turn of the 20th century. On the right, you have what we call the network analysis, the critical path method. This was essentially developed in the 1950s and really drew upon the basis of the Gantt chart, but looked at optimal timing for undertaking the works. In terms of modern planning, the example I showed of the golf club extension a few moments ago is a software that essentially draws a bar and Gantt chart. And then because of the way you logic link that program, it then essentially creates the critical path. So it uses the network analysis behind the scenes to work out the optimal period and the critical path for those works. So modern planning software essentially, in my eyes, joins the two together, the bar chart and the network analysis. And that is the mainstay of project planning across probably 95% of projects plus. The other perhaps 5% of projects look at something called the line of balance, which is shown at the bottom left here. And this is a tool which I've not come across greatly, but is used particularly on repetitive type projects. So perhaps a highway, a bridge, a tunnel, or in this example here, a housing development scheme. And essentially what this chart shows is the rate of progress of each of the key trades. And from this simple example, you can see that the real driver for this scheme is the timber frame output. And because of the slant of those works, it's considerably longer to undertake those works than the other elements. Because of that, you'll see that the brickwork, which follows on from the timber frame, there is a gap. You wouldn't want to start the brickwork too soon because it would catch up with the timber frame, which is going at a slower rate of progress. And essentially the line of balance is, it gives you an indication of where you should be in terms of each trade against each element of that scheme. So in this example, the buildings or the houses at any given point in time. As I say, it's used on certain projects. It's not as common as that common in my experience, even on certain repetitive projects. Quite often they like to rely on some sort of bar chart as opposed to a line of balance. But it's a tool that's available and want to be aware of, I guess. In terms of other ways of conveying the plan, we have planners typically get involved in logistics planning. So the example on the left here of a site, you can see the red hoarding line of this building is quite constrained. There's only one access route in. There is a canal to one side. There is private land on either side around it. So a very constrained site. You'd have to, if you're building this project, really consider your access and egress for deliveries, for lay down of materials and such like in the context of this scheme. And that would no doubt have an impact on how long it would take to build. And that is the role of the planner, to get involved in that type of logistics planning. And something I find quite enjoyable at the outset. As well as that, you have in more recent years 4D planning. It's been quite slow to take off in my experience, but it's essentially merging the BIM model with the programming software to have a connection between the model and the program to convey in perhaps more simpler way format than the bar chart how the project is going to be constructed over time. I think it's had a slow start. I've seen it on a few occasions. I think there's potentially a lot of growth in this area. And I think anyone who's perhaps new in their career to really, if they're interested in planning, to really get to grips with 4D planning, because I'm sure it will take off more so in the coming years. And then finally at the bottom right, a simple chart of resource planning, histogram of the resources. So the yellow represents planned resources over time, and the blue represents the actual. Again, the role of the planner is quite often to be involved with the resource planning. It's as I explained earlier, you develop your plan based on output rates, which implies what resources are applicable to the project over time, and then it's really measuring against whether you're achieving that as the project progresses. So different ways of programming, of conveying the plan to the wider audience. Just to conclude on that difference between the plan and the program, I think it's really important to highlight that in my eyes, the plan is essentially the course of action created in advance. So this is how you're going to achieve the delivery of that scheme successfully. And as I said, I think that should be owned by the team as a whole. The successful projects that do that, I think the projects that are successful do have that impetus from the outset. And then the program itself, perhaps you could describe as detailed notes of the intended proceedings. And that is how you're going to put that plan into action and monitor against that plan. And again, I think that's the element managed by the planner and owned by the planner. And that's the tool that then conveys the overall plan to the wider stakeholders to that project. So that's essentially how we build a plan, how we convey it in a program, perhaps at the outset of a project when it first starts. The next area I'm just going to touch on fairly briefly is how do you use that program as a management tool? So, you know, you create an optimal program at the outset, what you think it's going to take to achieve that project. Obviously, construction is subject to change. You know, unknown events do occur, and that plan you had at the outset may well change, and most likely nearly also as circumstances does. So the role of the planner then is to essentially visit the site, to walk around the site at any point in time, capture the status of the works, so the percentage of complete for all of those activities, to then consider that status of the works against any change that might have occurred. There may be variations, delays, whether they be outside of your control as a contractor or not. And then to consider all of that in terms of where you were originally and where you stand now. And to essentially update the program based upon progress as it stands. And in doing so, what it then essentially does, if your program has been properly linked together, it has proper durations at the outset that are reflective of accurate periods, then in putting that current progress into that program, you essentially can reforecast when you now may finish. You can also importantly reforecast the evolving critical path. I think that's an important point to note, because good planning as the project progresses is always to concentrate effort on the critical path at that point in time. And that critical path may change as time goes on. So the plan is not just something to be created at the outset, it's a live management tool to assist in keeping the program on track, to assist in resolving issues in terms of delays should they occur, and to put a plan in place going forward for how you may overcome those issues to hopefully achieve the completion date that you set out to do at the beginning. Touching on the role of the programme in terms of a management tool, I'm just going to very briefly touch on a concept known as float, because it's really important to any programme. Float is what we determine as the amount of time that any task in that programme can be delayed without causing subsequent delay to the next task in line or the end date itself. And as I say, if you're going to use the program as a management tool, you need to understand this concept of float in general terms. What I've got to do this is a simple example here, which you can find on Wikipedia. I think it's a really good example. And what we have here is a set of program activities. A to F is one main path. There's another path through the words A, G, H, and F. If you look at the relationship between A to F, they're all very close to time. So any delay to any of these activities will impact the end date. As a result, there is no float on this path. So you'll see there it's a free float and total float, both at zero. In simple terms, free float is how much time an activity can slip before it delays the follow-on activity. And total float is how much time the activity can slip without affecting the end date. Of the two, total float is the real key one to consider. So as I said, A to F, if there's any delays on A to F, it will cause the end date to be forecast to be late. However, if you look at A, G, H, and F, you'll see that there's some gap in terms of time between G and H and F. Because of that gap in time, those two activities can slip up to a certain period of time without affecting the end date. So in this example here, G has free float of 5 days, so it can slip 5 days without affecting H, and it has 8 days of total float, which implies that it can slip 8 days without affecting the end date, which is activity F. So quite important concept float to understand in basic terms, because it really does, is critical to, or crucial to any program and how you manage that program. That's the sort of theory behind it. If we just put this into a simple example, of flow, just to put it, hopefully explain the concept. If we suppose that the completion of the brickwork on a house is critical the day that the roof can commence, and in parallel with that brickwork for the roof works, the bricklayer is to also build a number of boundary walls around that building. Now, typically on a project, the critical path will go through, in this example, the building itself. So you need to get the brickwork up for the main building to allow the roof timbers to commence, which then allow the roof felting to commence, the tiling, and then the fit out of that building itself. If in this example all those bricklayers were to construct the boundary walls, well, they would potentially cause delays to the project as a whole, because those boundary walls are not critical. In essence, they can be completed at any point in time before the works themselves are complete. So what in this instance you should do is concentrate on the brickwork for the house itself. Once that is all complete and the roof works are ongoing and the internal fit out is ongoing, those bricklayers should then move on to the non-critical boundary walls. So float is crucial in any complex program to understanding where your priorities should lie. And that really helps with efficient deployment of resources and really helps to achieve completion on time. So it's quite a complex, float can be a bit complex when you first read up on it and trying to understand it, but it's quite an important point to note. in my eyes, for any programme as it progresses. Just conscious of time, I've probably gone over a little bit, so I'm going to just speed up a little bit more on these last few slides. This is a typical example of a programme that's been updated to reflect time now. So you'll see a lot of yellow lines, which are the baseline position. That's where the project was at the outset. And all the blue lines, bars, denote the fact that this whole project has slipped, has all been pushed out, simply because the first activity, in this example, which is called pile caps and ground beams, hasn't commenced on time as it was intended to do so. Very simple example of a critical path through a programme. You have a column here that shows a critical delay. In this case, it's about 4 weeks late, and that total flow column. So the software can show the flow. It shows in this instance here that these activities have 0 days flow, hence they are currently critical to finishing this scheme. So at this point in time, this project is behind progress by around 4 weeks. If you wanted to speed this up, this program, you would concentrate your efforts in terms of resources on this first activity at this point in time. Pile caps and ground beams, you may look to bring other extra resources in to try and recover some time. So that just shows how the role of the planner is to continually update the program as it progresses from the start to the finish. So that hopefully was a bit of a whistle-stop tour of project planning in general. Touching on then planning as a career, I won't go through this in too much detail because there's a link here to the website Go Construct, which I think is run by the CITB, which gives you an overview of the role of the planner. A lot of these bullet points will touch on things I've gone through already. So the role is to create the programme, it's to oversee logistics, deploy workers, manage budgets and so forth, to work closely with various members of the team, perhaps estimators, engineers, surveyors and architects. And as I said, I see the role of the planner as kind of integral to communication with the whole team. So real communication of that plan is important. So everyone, you know, whether they be the design team, the delivery team, understand the requirements, you know, and when deliverables are required as the project progresses. I mean, there's further points on the role of the planner. We've covered a lot of these. Producing reports as the project progresses, using the tools to project manage the time frame for that project and so forth. The list is quite extensive, which is in my eyes what I quite like about planning. It's quite a broad element of the project. You're not too niche, you get to involved in all aspects of the project. You get to see the project as a whole and all the people involved in it. Meetings with contractors and suppliers is key. I think when you're building a programme, talk to the specialists. They often have a more specialist knowledge of particular elements of work. So cladding is a classic example. Cladding is quite intricate. Speak to the cladding supplier or subcontractor, how they plan to build those works and such like. And again, the final bullet really is that the role of the planner is quite varied between office. You might be a tender planner in the office. You might be a visiting planner across a number of sites, or equally, if it's a huge project, you might be on that site permanently. So there's a lot of variety in the role as I see it. Touch on a few points of mine in terms of the career in planning. A lot of people think planning just works for the main contractor, and there is a huge scope to do so, particularly as a planner. You may then be promoted to senior planning manager, managing a region or a division. But also look outside of that, there's lots of roles within the project management side of things, within those types of consultancies. Quite often those projects, they don't necessarily call people planners, but they're more project controls engineers or project control managers. Their remit is typically, in my view, more of a reporting role in terms of covering time as well as sometimes risk and cost elements of a large scheme and integrating all of those together. So earned value management is a term that's often applied to that type of role. And then beyond that, there are lots of consultancies that deal with the difficulties of planning. when things go wrong, typically known as dispute resolution firms, where the role is to entangle the issues on that project and to consider that in some formal sort of report for any tribunal. It could be an adjudication or arbitration and such like. Many people who work in that area have typically started off with a main contractor or project management consultancy and really got some first-hand and experience of planning before moving into that role. But I think that the aim of this slide is really to convey that there's quite a broad area of work in the industry that you can get involved in, and different types of planning or project controls that go with that. In terms of advice I would give anyone who's interested in project planning in a bit more detail, first thing would be to gain site experience. I think that is invaluable later on in your career. So if you can work as a site manager, site engineer, perhaps a quantity surveyor, any role on site, that will help you immensely should you then decide to go into the role as a planner later on. I think technical skills are really important as a planner. Don't concentrate overly on the software itself. That will follow in time, but really get to grasp with the technical skills. And as I said earlier, one of the key technical skills, in my view as a planner, is estimating. So estimate how long things will take. Being able to read the drawings, read the bill of quantities, do a simple takeoff of the key elements of work that will help you to really get a sort of, as I said earlier, a quantitative feel for the scope involved in the scheme. And that gives a good bedrock framework for you to then explain your reasoning for how long things are going to take to other members of the team, and why you've decided on certain durations for certain tasks. And I think finally, the softer skills are really important. As a planner, it's about communicating that plan. It's really important to not just update the program, but communicate where things are at, communicate change, communicate how the critical path has changed as the project has evolved to help the wider team members concentrate on what's important as the project goes on. And then the final bullet there is leadership, in terms of you know, being able to convey your program and have confidence in it to other members of the team. So that is planning in a nutshell, in 45 minutes or so. Hopefully it was of interest to anyone who perhaps is looking at this as an area of future work. I'll just conclude with a few links to further resources, which I think perhaps are of interest to people. The first one is the Go Construct site, which talks about the career of the planner. The second is a link to a CIOB document known as the Planning Protocol. It came out last year. Quite a good document to give you some basic understanding of good planning, how to link a program, how to develop the period for the program for each activity, and some good pointers really in a simple document, which can be downloaded from the CIOB website. Third one is a link to the Tomorrow's Leaders element of the CIOB website. CIOB is really keen to get more student members or those who are at the outset of their careers to join. And I would really recommend that to anyone to look at the Tomorrow's Leaders link, to look at becoming a student member, because you'll see lots of good papers on the website of the CIOB that you can download, resources, videos of training videos and such like on different topics, as well as links to all the events that are held. And again, Chair of the Magistrate Hub, I'm really keen to see more people attend. Students, we really would welcome you to come along or listen in to some of our talks, which are all referenced on the website. Final link there is to a website called Planning Planet, which is kind of a forum for planners to get together, to share various documents. You'll also find output rates. So if you're looking for how long it takes to perhaps do a meter squared of brickwork or a meter squared of plastering and such like, there are some reference there to typical periods to do so. So that's quite a good resource, I think, for anyone who wants to create a program, whether that's for your course or for your work, to perhaps have a look at what's on there. So that concludes my talk. Again, if anyone wants any specific questions, please feel free to drop me an email on the details here. More than happy to help if I can, and give any sort of general advice on anything discussed. So that concludes. If I come out of the screen here, and I stop sharing, I think Kat can look for any particular questions, if anyone has any.
I think we've got a couple who are just starting to come in. So again, if you do have any, please just pop them in that question box. And we'll be able to, well, Tom will be able to answer them.
I'll try my best.
I'll echo what Tom said there. It is worth having a look at student membership, or potentially what your routes to full chartered membership will be if you're coming close to graduating, or if you're on a master's course. I'm more than happy. I work as the regional manager for the North, and I'm more than happy to talk to anyone about their route to membership and how they can achieve that and what the benefits are. So I will drop everyone an email afterwards with my contact details and also with a copy of the slides, if that's okay with you, Tom.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. No problem.
We've still got your screen showing. Do you want to?
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Okay. Is that gone now?
Yeah, that's gone now. Fantastic. So I'll answer the easy one first. Can we have the video recording? The video recording will be made available, but it does have to go through some editing first. So it will take a little while. It won't be an automatic thing. But when it is available, we'll make sure we send it out to all of your universities and colleges. And it will also be available on our YouTube channel as well, under the Tomorrow's Leaders CIOB. If you type in CIOB, there's a whole playlist of ones that are relevant for tomorrow's leaders that cover a whole range of introduction to topics, so you'll find lots of interesting things there. And then one for you, Tom. So thank you for sharing, very appreciated. My question is, do you use any agile tools in previous project planning?
I've heard the term agile planning. It's not something I've come across personally, albeit the work I do at the moment is a little bit away from live planning. I do more sort of report writing for disputes generally. So I haven't personally come across those tools. I think they are used, as I understand it, on certain projects to kind of, as I understand it, manage workflow as the project progresses. One tool that I have come across a lot when I've been on projects is something we call Last Planner. And this is, I think, a really good tool, which is to try and get the plan to be thought about by those who are delivering the work. So typically, Last Planner is the last person in the chain. So it's the managers, the supervisors of all the, perhaps the contractors, get together, let's say on a Friday, look at what they're going to plan the next week. Look at the constraints that exist at that time, what are the issues, look at who's going to take priority over one another. And I think schemes where I've seen that type of discipline happening, it really works well, because you're not just reactive to what's going to happen the next week, you're actually proactively planning. And it's not the planners doing that, it's the team who are delivering the scheme itself. And I think that sort of Last Planner is called, or it has some sort of similar names, I think is a really good tool that works well on complex projects. So hopefully that sort of answered your question.
Thank you, Tom. There haven't been any more come through, so please do ask. Here we go. For Last Planner, is it more of a soft skill or a software skill?
Last Planner is a soft skill. It's not, yeah. So Last Planner is not really about the program. It's not, I mean, some people might put the program on perhaps a whiteboard or a large TV, but it's a soft skill. It's about that conveying, it's about everyone owning the plan in my eyes. It's about, you know, the workforce not just ignoring programs on the wall, but it's actually thinking about what they're delivering in the next week or two. And it's drawn upon, know, sort of materials plan, resources, and sort of forward planning that. And I think the term Last Planner is, as I say, the last person to think about the plan. And it works, it does work well. When I've seen it in practice, I've been involved in it. I think it's really good to sort of push drive a project forward. So yeah, it's a soft skill rather than a software based tool. I mean, the only software typically involved is you might have a big whiteboard where people are annotating on a screen, it's usually a plan of the site, and somebody will, one contractor will say, well, I'm laying down my seal work in that area. The other contractor will say, well, I was planning to put my my drainage layer down there before I install it. The project manager, the construction manager, the main contractor's role then is to say, well, actually, the optimal thing to do is that you, the seal contractor puts his equipment or his material there. The other contractor perhaps goes, we'll clear up another area for you and so forth. So the only software is literally a screen with a view of the layout of the site typically. So that's, you know, it's not a software intense exercise. It's more about getting everyone around a room, around a table to discuss what the upcoming issues are.
Great, thank you. We've actually got a slew of questions coming in now, but I'm aware that we are coming up to the end of the time. Now, Tom, have you got to dash off at half?
I'm happy to answer and stay if needed.
Lovely. We'll do a few more questions then there. So we've had a couple about 4D planning. One is, how is the industry adapting to BIM in regards to project planning?
Okay, so I first heard of 4D planning probably 10 years ago. I'm guessing it was really talked about. It has been quite slow in my experience to take off 4D planning. I think the issue there is possibly, it's quite resource intense, I think, to do. I think also the skill set is slightly different. Typically planners can use a software, but this is a new challenge to be able to look at a model, understand how a BIM model works, and draw that into the program itself. And I think that skill set's not quite there in the industry generally. However, I think that's an opportunity for anyone who's interested in the topic to really, you know, perhaps push themselves in that area. I think it's going to be a future skill, no doubt. It's just, I think, like a lot of things in the industry, it's been quite slow to take off. That's my experience. Where I've seen it done, I have seen it on major schemes where we're talking schemes of work on which are £500 million plus. They will invest in the 4D plan at the outset. My experience has been, though, because the project moves so fast thereafter, you've got multiple trade contractors all trying to align each other's program to one another. That model just simply can't keep up, you know, with the evolving change. And what you end up really then using is simply typical traditional planning software. So it's how you integrate that system into a large complex project and are able to maintain it as the project goes along. That's the bit I've not yet seen in practice successfully work. It's not to say it's not happening. Someone out there's not doing that. I just haven't yet seen it myself. But yeah, it's a future skill it's going to happen. There's no doubt about it. So I would advise anyone who's looking at planning to really, you know, if you're at the beginning of your career, rather than sort of mid-career where I am, to really concentrate on that. And I think you'll find a good role for yourself in doing so.
Great. Thank you. And the other one that was around 4D planning is about a specific, I'm assuming this is a specific piece of software. Have you had any success with 4D planning using Elecosoft Aster PP?
Yes, yeah, so Elecosoft Aster is Aster or Power Project is one of the main software packages. And they have a 4D planning tool. I've seen it in use. I personally haven't used it that to a great extent. There are other tools out there, Synchro, there's various tools that are used in that area, which all interface with different planning softwares differently. So yeah, anyone who's interested, I'll just do a bit of research. You'll come across probably a handful of the main tools used. Yeah, to me, it's that training and knowledge or for planners to be able to not just plan works, which we've traditionally done, but also manage BIM models and the like, which is, it's that interface between the two. And the time it takes to perhaps create that model is probably the things holding it back from being used at the moment to the extent it perhaps should be.
Great, thank you. And then the last one we've got at the moment is a bit more of a general one. Are there differences of opinion between the planner and the project manager on site issues? And how is this relationship generally?
So I always say that the role of the planner is almost to work very closely with the project manager. There are differences of opinion and the challenges. The planner may quite often will be closer to the detail of exactly the status of the works. They walk around everything, they've got a real good feel for how much the works complete at any point in time. They may assess that against the programme and it's showing a large slippage. The project manager is under pressure from the client to be delivering against a certain date. A tension can arise there between the two sometimes. So it's not easy being a project manager, but equally it's not easy being a planner. There are unique challenges in each. I think where it really works is where the two are aligned close together, and the project manager takes the input from the planner and takes on board that input. So if the planner is saying the project is late, we've slipped on this area, this originally another area was critical. So let's suppose you've got two buildings on a site, building A and B. When you did a tender program, contract program, building A was critical. However, you're halfway through the project, you've put all your resources on A and it's ahead of itself and you've ignored B. B might now be the critical path. And the role of a good relationship between the planner and the project manager, where the planner is informing the project manager of the status, the project manager then decides to divert those resources to the critical area each month. If you just contract the critical area each month, you will hopefully stop losing time or recover it. So working hand in hand between the two is key, but there are challenges, on any project between people who have got slightly different aims from their role. But I do think successful projects are where, the project management team and the planning team work hand in hand. You have to. I think there's no other alternative, really. So hopefully that sort of answers the question.